After this class, we're going to. You remember we started our discussion? Okay, today's class is going to be a brief class. Unfortunately, at 3:15, I have to go or something. Okay? But anyway, when the 6 open. Hey, and the other thing is, next week, all of next week, I'm on holiday. I apologize for this, there will be no class. For this reason, I'm going to propose we have 3 classes a week for the next few weeks. Okay? So before we do anything else, let's fix on the timings. So apart from Mondays and Thursdays, I need one more slot on a regular basis. Can you suggest one? Is this slot okay?
Tuesday.
Tuesday or Wednesday, do that. I'll just check which of the days, if any, of the classes. Tuesday is fine. So shall we fix that? Mondays, Tuesdays, and Thursdays. At least for a few things. I suppose there's just 4 weeks left. If you don't mind, we just take 3 classes. Okay. So we'll fix on Tuesdays, 2:30. Same class. See, Monday, Tuesday, Thursday. Okay. So we began a discussion of cosmology. We discussed that our universe, we're going to make a model of our universe according to the following metric. And we talked about the idea that the metric in three-dimensional space, we talked about the idea that the metric in this three-dimensional space was going to be special in some way. Okay? Today I want to make that notion of what is something being special in the model space. Okay? So, firstly, let me make a couple of definitions. We've more or less seen before, but anyway. Definition: an isometry is a coordinate change such that the metric in the new coordinates takes the same functional form as the metric in the new coordinates. Parametrized by vector field. We know that delta G mu nu is equal to delta mu zeta nu, because you know, by the definition of an isometry, the metric should not change. Okay? So, under an infinite, you know, a vector field parameterizes an infinitesimal isometry if and only if del mu zeta mu plus del mu zeta mu is equal to zero. A vector field that satisfies this equation is called a killing field. Okay? And parameterizes infinitesimal isometry. We work with infinitesimals because those are convenient. But of course, the infinitesimals can be exponential. You can make the quadrant change, small quadrant, then another, then another, then another, to generate the finite quadrant change. So there's no lack of information in infinitesimals.
So all metrics
converge
to infinity.
No. So the general metric has no isometries. There are no coordinate transformations that leave its functional form unchanged. And no killing vectors. So it's only special spacetimes that admit killing vectors or admit isometries. Okay.
So isometry, is it required for that to be defined all over the space?
This is our definition, yes.
Like, can you have isometries which are partial in space?
What happens in the rest of it? You know, if it may be useful for. If you're only interested in physics and that's it. Yes. But this is not our definition. Okay. Now.
So then solving for the equation looking for solutions of theta.
You could think of it that way. If you want to know whether the spacetime has any isometries, you write down this equation and check to see if there are any solutions.
That's what the general are multiple solutions.
That in general there are no solutions.
Or multiple solutions.
Could have multiple solutions. But in arbitrary manifold will have no solutions. Okay. Now, why have I started talking about isometries and these killing vectors? I started talking about them because I now want to tell you what more precisely I mean by the statement that the spacetime is homogeneous and isotropic. Okay? Consider a little patch around any given point. What does it intuitively mean that space is isotropic, at least about that point? It means that that if you set up your little local coordinate axis, it doesn't matter how you orient it for this. Okay? Now, what does doesn't matter mean? It means that rotation of your little local coordinate axis can be generated by symmetry. One of the symmetries in our theories, the symmetries in our theories are the isometries. The only field in the theory is the metric. If the metric doesn't change, what does happen? Okay? So, a space is said to be isotropic at a given point if all rotations of the local frame at that point are generated by isometries. How many parameters are there? Suppose we're in p-spatial dimensions. Or, since I'm talking about this cosmological concept, context of problems, the spatial dimension. Everything I say could be generalized as space-time metrics. Okay? Suppose we're in p-spatial dimensions. If the space is isotropic about even one point, there must be a certain minimum number of k. What's the number? P minus 1 by 2, because that is the number of rotations. So, if the space is isotropic around a given point, the minimum number of k. Okay? Now, next question. What does it mean for a space to be homogeneous? What it means for the space to be homogeneous is that in your little local patch, and by extension, everywhere. There is, so I should be more precise about what I said about the isometry. That there is a killing vector that vanishes at a point. So, what are the isometries? Isometries are, you know, we want everything to rotate, but not for the point to move. So, we would like killing vectors that vanish at that point, but whose derivatives, you know, in the neighborhood of that point, generate all rotations. Okay? And the example of this is rotations in flat space. Okay? So suppose we had the origin of flat space is rotation in vector. What are the killing vectors that generate these rotations?
It's x mu and mu minus x.
They vanish at the point, but they rotate things in the neighborhood. Okay, so this is what I mean. This is what I mean by a space being isotropic at a given point. And if it's isotropic at that point, then it has at least p into p minus 1 by 2 killing vectors. What do I mean by homogeneity? What I mean by homogeneity is that there is a killing vector that takes you from a given, from any point to any other. Infinite in the singular neighborhood, and then by extension in the whole space. Okay, so there is a coordinate change, so it takes one point to any other. Okay, isotropy can be defined about a point. Homogeneity is the manifold. Okay, if a manifold is homogeneous, it has at least p given vectors, because that's the dimension of the manifold. Okay, now, I'm going to quote some results for you without proving them. But these results are very nicely explained in Weinberg's book on the chapter of symmetric spaces. Okay, I'm not going to go through the proofs basically because we are running out of time. But, yes? A killing vector field need not vanish at a point. But if that killing vector is an isometry, then it does. That's part of a definition. So an isometry is like a local rotation of a vector. So the translational killing vector doesn't vanish. Okay. Now, first result. Okay. Okay. You cannot have more than p into p plus 1 by 2 killing vectors in any space. And the way you prove this result is by showing that suppose you've got killing vectors, zeta mu. Then, using the killing equation, you can prove that del sigma del rho of zeta mu is equal to minus r lambda sigma rho mu zeta. This is a general identity. You can prove for anything. Just using algebra. I won't try to go through. It's a little algebra. I won't go through. We'll prove for you. But it's a general identity very nicely explained in my notes. Okay? Well, why is this important? This is important because, look, what we've done in this with this equation is express two derivatives of the killing vector in terms of the killing vector. So now we can take this equation and differentiate. So we'll get expressions for three derivatives of the killing vector in terms of derivatives of the curvature and derivatives of the killing vector. But we've already expressed two derivatives of the killing vector in terms of killing vector. So what this means is that once you know that the killing vector itself and its first derivative, then you know all its other derivatives. Okay? Which means that the delta in a Kape vector field is contained entirely in the value of the Kape vector and the value of its first derivative at a point. At one point, that determines the whole vector field. Right? Because you can construct the whole field by Taylor's expansion. Is this clear? Hey, how about putting a few more lines? Show this as a simple identity, but its consequences are enormous. Okay? So, that tells you that the number of possible Killing vectors, let's look at a point. The number of possible Killing vectors is entirely determined by the number of pieces of data in the vector Killing vector field at that point. And its derivatives. Moreover, its derivatives are not free because they replace this equation. So now can you, somebody help me do the counting? How many pieces of data are there as the value of the derivative at a point obeying this equation? Right, how many pieces of data are the derivative of a field at a point? Wait, which question answer that? Suppose we didn't impose this condition, how many pieces of data are the derivative of vector field at a point? Huh? P squared.
Yes.
Now with this condition, how many? P into? Louder, somebody can please come and say louder. Something by 2 words. P minus 1. You're removing the symmetric part. You're counting only the anti-symmetric part. It's P into P minus 1 vector. This is the number of pieces of data in the derivative. There's also data in the value of the Killing vector. How many pieces of data in the value of the Killing vector at the point? P. Maximum number of Killing vectors, Killing vector fields a manifold can have. Because, well, these are the independent pieces of data which completely reconstruct the Killing vector field. The maximum number of Killing vector fields you can have in a manifold is P into P plus 1 by 2. Okay? Now, let's look at this P into P plus 1 by 2. It happens to be the number that you get from by adding P to P minus 1 by 2, local rotations, and P, which are local translations. Okay? So, from just this counting numerology, it might suggest to you that, and it's true, that a space-time, or a space, that is both isotropic and homogeneous. If it's isotropic about one point and homogeneous, then it's isotropic about every point. Because the homogeneity is a Killing vector that moves one every point to every other. So that a space that is isotropic about one point and homogeneous in the manifold has the maximal number of Killing vectors possible. Which is P into P plus 1 by 2. And then it has a name, what does he call it? It's maximally symmetric. We call it maximally symmetric. Such a space is also isotropic about every point. Okay? Another bit of algebra you can do to show, again, nice thing in Weinberg's book, is that if a space is isotropic about every point, then it must also be homogeneous. Okay? So all of these are the same thing. So when I talk about a maximally symmetric space, that is, there are many characterizations of it, all of which I could. A, that it has P into P plus 1 by 2 Killing vectors. B, that it is isotropic about any one point and homogeneous. C, that it is isotropic about every point. All these three completely say the same thing and define maximally symmetric spaces as homogeneous and isotropic spaces. Okay? Now, the other, all that I've said now, I've not explained the algebra, though I could have in a total of 15 minutes. Okay? The result is now going to go to takes a little more. It's a uniqueness theorem for maximalist metrics. See, suppose you've got some symmetric space, and you can of course take it and scale it. Take the metric and multiply it by an overall number. That will also be maximalist metric. That's a trivial operation. So clearly, if symmetric spaces are, you've got one symmetric space, you can generate one parameter set of symmetric spaces by scaling. Now the scaling will change the curvature. It's something that is strongly curved because it's small, but completely curved because it's big. So, symmetric spaces can't be completely unique because there's the scaling operation. It's like for the sphere, right? Big sphere or small sphere. Okay. However, you might wonder whether symmetric spaces are unique up to the scale. The answer is yes. Okay? So, more precisely, given the signature of the space, right? Everything, I can talk about space, but everything I say is true, space time. Given the signature of the space time and the value of its Ricci scalar, Ricci curvature, which is a measure of how big it is, the scale of Ricci changes in size. Okay? So, given. By the way, can somebody tell me if I scale the metric G goes to lambda G, how does the Ricci scale? 1 by lambda. G goes to lambda G. That's same as distance goes to lambda square. The radius goes to lambda. So G is like radius square. Let me argue. The curvature, okay? The curvature is has terms that go like gamma, gamma, for instance. Remember, gamma was like G inverse DG. So gamma and curvature, so things like, gamma and wait a minute, I'm getting confused as much. So R mu nu scales like gamma, because it's gamma times gamma, just like a matrix. Okay? And this is independent of the overall scale of the metric. You take G to lambda G, R mu nu just does not change. But R is equal to G inverse. R mu nu. So R scales like G inverse. So you multiply metric by lambda, the Ricci scalar scales like 1 by lambda. Big space and small curve. It's intuitive, right? Okay, but just getting back. Where were we, right? So the uniqueness theorem. The uniqueness theorem is that given the value of the Ricci scalar, that's just setting the scale, and given the signature of space time, there is a unique, completely symmetric. Okay, this takes a little more proving, but it's also nicely proven. Given all of this information, okay, it is very easy to construct all symmetric, all maximalist spaces. And I'm now going to so one maximum symmetric space that we constructed already last class was S3. How do we know that it's maximally symmetric? Well, it's intuitively obvious that it's homogeneous and isotropic. But can you count the number of killing vectors in S3? What is the set of coordinate changes that leaves the metric of S3 unchanged? Think of S3 being embedded in R. Four dimensional rotations. How many 4-dimensional rotations are there?
Six.
What is 3 into 3 plus 1 by 2? 6. It's 3, 4 by 2. So, S3 has the number of isometries in S3. is 6. Therefore, it's a maximally symmetric space. Okay? So if we're searching for a space, or more generally a space-time, that is maximally symmetric, what we need to do is to search for spaces or space-times that have as many isometries as they can have. Okay? So now the example of S3 has given us has shown us how to think. Okay. So, but firstly, R equals 0, clearly, the unique manifold is flat space. Flat space has P into P plus 1 by 2 isometries, obviously. It's P into P minus 1 by 2 rotations plus P translations. So flat space is maximally symmetric. The sphere is maximally symmetric. Now, let me try to find other examples of manifolds that are maximally symmetric. Okay. Suppose I look at this manifold. Now, this is close to what Amit was talking about last time. Suppose I look at this manifold. Suppose I look at the manifold minus x0 squared plus x1 squared plus x2 squared. Is equal to the only change we need to do from what you were suggesting last time? Your minus. Okay? Is equal to minus x squared. Okay. Now, let's think of this as embedded in R 1, 3. One time-like dimension. In like ordinary processes. This, as a manifold, the manifold is left invariant by all Lorentz transformations. Clearly, because that expression is Lorentz invariant. Okay? So every Lorentz transformation maps points of this manifold to other points on the same manifold. You don't leave this hypersurface by the edge. So now, what is the number of isometries in this manifold? So this is 6, because there are 6 Lorentz transformations. Okay? Now, let's think more about this manifold. First, what is the signature of this manifold? Can somebody help me understand? But firstly, what is the dimensionality? 3 dimensions. Now, what is the signature?
Minus plus.
How many things? You see, we want to know what is the good set of coordinates on this manifold. You can see it by doing equations, but intuitively, how do you see it? You see it by the following way. This equation can be written as x0 squared is equal to a squared plus x1 squared plus x2 squared plus x2 squared. Okay? So we can, at every x1, x2, and x3, we can solve for x0 in terms of x1, x2. So we can think of the space being parametrized by x1, x2. Okay, since x1, x2, x3 are spatial dimensions, perhaps this gives you some, it's not a proof, but some reason for believing that that this thing will be, the signature will be 3. I'm going to show it to you now. Okay. By the way, this is not symmetric. Suppose you're trying to solve for x1 squared. Okay. If you solve x1 squared, you will get is equal to x0 squared minus a squared minus x2 squared minus x3 squared. And then there will be some values of x2 and x3 which are large enough so that you could solve for x1 squared. So while x1, x2, x3 are good coordinates of this manifold everywhere, if you try to choose some other set, it would not be good.
Again, hypersurface in R3, R4 will essentially be the case of plus 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 because the induced metric will always be positive. Any distance in the induced sense is positive. Any hypersurface? Because I don't think any hypersurface in R4 will
happen. This is not R4, it's R1,3. Suppose I take this hypersurface 1,3 and look at this.
So you're solving it in R5. Is solving this equation an R5?
In R1, 3. We'll see exactly what calculation we need to do to check this. But it's not true that every hypersurface will be of the signature. Suppose we take the hypersurface x3 equals 0. That would be 2 plus 1 dimensional in Kursky space, which has signature minus plus plus. So it depends on the hypersurface. You know, what I'm saying is very intuitive. This time and the space. If you said t equals 0, for instance, you've got a spatial hypersurface. If you said x equals 0, you've got a hypersurface that includes that. This is some funny combination of the two.
Are you looking for solutions in x1, x0, x1, x2, x3? Such that the equation is okay. In R4.
Wait. Firstly, we're not working in R4, we're working in R1, 3. Space-time, the metric of the embedding space-time is dt squared minus x1 squared minus x2 squared. Okay? Yes. Now, I've written down a particular equation for a hypersurface. And then there is a question, is this hypersurface of signature plus plus plus? Or is this hypersurface of signature minus plus plus? Depending on the equation in question, the answer will be different. So it's not an empty question.
So what is the physical significance of signature?
Signature means, well, are you dealing with a space or a space-time?
How are they manifold that have both temporal and spatial?
Well, if there is a minus signature, then it's a space-time. Yes.
But they won't all be x0 equal to constant.
No, no, it's just, what is the signature of the metric?
Yes, so that's what I asked. I mean, let's say you have the surface which has some temporal extent. It's not some x not equal to constant surface. So it's not intuitively space time. Then, I mean, if you have this other surface.
It's just, it'll be some space on which there is some metric. And are all directions in which you go space directions or some of the time directions?
Is it physically, is there some measure of when a signature is not, like, it's not plus plus plus? If I am on a hypersurface, how do I find out what the signature is?
Okay, so let's do it for this particular case. Okay, you do it by just computing the metric of the surface. Well, for many ways. Basically, you just take. Well, there are many ways, okay? But let's just do it by computing the metric of the surfaces. Okay, in this particular case. So now, in this case, the coordinate system that we use for the sphere is now. The first coordinate system we use for the sphere is now very natural. Because this case does not have a SO4 symmetry. There isn't a 3-sphere problem, but there is a 2-sphere. So now suppose we write x1 is equal to r sine theta cos phi, x2 is equal to r sine theta sin phi, x3 is equal to r sine theta cos theta, and x4 is equal to a squared plus r squared. Okay? Then, this is a very natural coordinate system. Let's compute what the metric is in this coordinate system. So the original metric was dt squared minus dx1 squared plus dx2 squared plus dx3 squared. Okay? Now plug in. Dx0 squared, and this is x0. Now just plug in. Okay? So, I'm just following the calculation made in the last class. From here we get r squared d omega 2 squared. Plus we also get dr squared. Dr squared. Exactly as we got this. Okay? And from here, we're going to get plus dr divided by square root of a squared plus r squared r squared. Combine these two terms together, we get minus r squared d omega 2 squared. Minus a squared dr squared over a squared plus r squared. The point I understand that this was always, that this came with a minus, was the fact that it was pure expansion.
Okay. I'm not sure, absolutely. I mean, let's see how it was high, so it was positive, positive. And you can physically say any curve I draw on this would always have a positive distance. It would be a positive distance.
It's simpler than that. Just start at a point. Move in every direction.
Right, see.
And see if the distance is positive.
That's
yeah.
So, in some sense, by introducing non positive definite metrics, you're introducing some arbitrary structure on hypersurface.
Well, you know, what we're doing is looking at a hypersurface in an embedding space which was not positive.
Which is not positive, definitely, but by virtue of that, you have this additional structure. On
additional the possibility.
Possibility, yeah. Namely the signature of the
hypersurface. Yes. Is this clear? Okay. So, this space has a name. Okay. This space is called Euclidean anti-de-Sitter space. Or Euclidean ABS space. Okay? It's a space, as we modulated last class, just like the sphere is a space of constant positive curvature. This is a space of constant negative curvature. Because, you know, all the formulas for this, the curvature of a sphere, the Ricci scale of a sphere was 1 by a squared. And all the formulas for this space just go over under the replacement a squared goes to minus a squared. So the curvature of a sphere, the Ricci scale of r is equal to minus 1. Okay? So this is Euclidean ABS space, is a space of constant negative curvature. Okay? It's a maximally symmetric space because we counted the number of isometrics. It's 6. Is it? That's right. It's an R4 version of R. Yes, but you know, we do it cleverly. It's a hyperbola really in R1, 3.
Overall distance is negative.
Overall distance is basically right. Okay, so we do it cleverly so as to get such a large amount of symmetry. You wouldn't get such a large amount of symmetry for a hyperbola in R2. Okay? Now, according to our theorem, Euclidean manifolds, symmetric spaces, completely symmetric spaces of signatures of with spaces with signature plus plus plus, that's completely classified by the Ricci scale. But we produce the manifold with every value to Ricci scale. So we've completely produced all symmetric Euclidean symmetric spaces. Okay, so they are the sphere of every radius, Euclidean radius of every, and it is a space of every radius. And flatness. And these are all three dimensions, but the proof would be proof in every dimension. Okay. These are all Euclidean maximally symmetric spaces. Is this clear? Okay. Now. Just since we've gone through this exercise, it's another little exercise one could do. And one could ask the following question. What about the manifold minus x0 squared minus x1 squared plus x2 squared plus x3 squared is equal to minus a squared? In R2 bar. Think of this as a hypersurface in R2 bar. This also has 6 killing vectors. It's SO 2,2. Same number as SO4. Okay? What is the signature of this space? Can somebody help me? What are the two possibilities? Could be one time in two space or two times in one space. Where is it? one time it was missing.
Same kind of argument. You can use to solve for x0 squared plus x1 squared, one of the time derivations, in terms of one of the space derivations. Okay? This space is what's called anti-Disaster space. This space was called Euclidean A S 3. 3 is just the dimension. This space is called ADS 3. Okay? And this is one of the spaces of one of the maximally symmetric spaces with signature 1 time and 2 space. Okay. Now, there is another maximally symmetric space with a signature 1 time and 2 space, which is called De Sitter space. And okay, that space is defined by an equation that is similar to this. We will come to the study of De Sitter space when we start talking about space times with cosmological constants very soon. So I'll postpone the discussion of that. Yeah. But just you see from this general construction that it is very easy, given a given any signature, it's very easy to produce maximally symmetric spaces just by starting from such hypersurfaces in R, M, comma, N. Okay, basically this idea completely classifies, you know, gives you a construction of all symmetric spaces in every space dimension. Okay, anti-De Sitter space is of no known importance in the real world, but it's very important in this current study of string theory. Okay, you could this just mathematically though, you could produce spaces like this of signature m comma n by starting with something with signature m comma n plus 1 in many spaces. Yes.
So if you, let's say we're doing some free theory on the space, is it possible to have boundary conditions put on one surface of one type of signature and the other surface of the other kind of signature?
I didn't answer
your
question. Well, are you working on a hypersurface or on the whole space time?
You're working on the whole space time.
Whole space time is this hypersurface or just R and
N? Let's say I'm working on a solution of Einstein.
Right. So this is a different question. It's not.
It's not this, but it's a related concept, okay. Namely of putting it in hypersurface.
Yes.
So our initial conditions would be on some hypersurface.
Yes.
Which would be space time.
Yes.
I'm asking, can you solve by giving it on one space-type hypersurface and another which is not space-type?
You're asking, can you put initial conditions on hypersurfaces which have a time? It's not what we normally do for physics. So it would be called an initial condition. Still, at the mathematical level, you can ask. You see, the equation del square equals zero is solved. You want to know what is sufficient data for solving this question. The answer is in this paper. Let's explore this.
So, like moving mirrors, you have to impose conditions on the time like that. Moving mirrors, say, with some photons, etc.
Yeah. You see, if you have a bound, just a box, the wall of a box is a timeline. So it's certainly permissible to impose boundary conditions.
That's physical.
Absolutely. It's certainly permissible to impose. But I thought Harshan's question was, in R form, let's say, could you, what surfaces can you put initial data?
Of course, actually.
Okay, whatever it is, let's postpone it after class. I'm going to have to stop the class in 2 minutes. Okay, great. So, now, okay, I think maybe we should just actually stop. So let's see. So, where have we got? We understand. our maximally symmetric spaces. These will be the building blocks we'll use for cosmology.
There's something I wanted to say.
So let's continue. Sorry, I have to run to it. Okay.